has on you and all the different things. So, everyone look. Okay? All looking. We have to get the elephant out of the room. I always wear a hat. That's the elephant in the room. And I got an iPhone. So, aside from that, you'll see my kick out. So, if I'm looking at this young lady, I'm also looking at that gentleman over there at the same time. So, I can see all of you. Great parents, right? How about the skills? So, what I want to do is talk about blood sugar. And I made a couple of notes here because I had a chance today. Every Wednesday is kind of my day to catch up with other doctors. I've got to talk with one when we finish here tonight. And I've got to talk. I talk to Dr. Howard Loomis every Wednesday. He mentored me. He taught me digestion. He's probably, I would say, one of the top 5 or 10 what I would consider natural holistic type physicians in the world. He's brilliant. Howard's absolutely brilliant. One of his right-hand men that I introduced myself to 22 years ago is one of my good friends now, Dr. Dennis Furking. Dennis is a sponge. He's around Dr. Loomis a lot, and he's around all Dr. Loomis's doctors that call in to him all the time a lot. And his knowledge base is really, it's unbelievable how far he goes into so many different disciplines. Because when you get into the natural field, the natural healthcare, there's lots of different ways to get to Rome, right? There's bunches of different things that work well. And so I always try to converse with both these gentlemen. I do Dennis at 4, Howard at 5, which is why I'm struggling to get here. I can't tell Howard no. He's 80 years old, and his window of time with me is really little. So I have to learn as much as I possibly can. And then I'll have Eric tonight around 9, probably, when we're all done. And so Wednesdays are fun for me because it's times I get to learn and explore and try new things and do new stuff. And blood sugar is something that I think is grossly overlooked, and I think it's something that we, as a population, don't understand very well. And it's something I'm afraid that if we don't get a better grip on it, we're not going to be here. And so ideally, and I have little facts I like to bring in that I think are important for you. Does anyone know, that hasn't seen him before, talk, how much money you're going to spend on health care in your lifetime? What's the average? Anyone? It's $400,000, according to CDC statistics, as of last year. $400,000 per person. Anybody in here married to each other, live in the same household? Okay, you got a couple of you now, there's 800 grand. Almost a million. Throw a kid in there and you're over. Okay? So you look at that and you start thinking, well, that's crazy. I won't spend that. That's the national average for everybody. So you start thinking about that and you think, all right, what am I getting for my $400,000 investment? How well do we do with heart disease? Number one killer in the country. Has been for 50 years. How about cancer? Number two killer in the country, has been for about 50 years or more. How about Alzheimer's? Anyone hear of that? Dementia? Right? Listen to these things. Anyone want them? Anyone wake up in the morning and go, man, I would love some liver cancer today. That'd be outstanding. Nobody wants that. The problem is you all know how to avoid it. You just don't. And that's why I decided to do this one. That's why I decided to talk about blood sugar. It's a major focus of my practice. And it's a little disturbing to me. And I actually made some notes about 15 minutes ago before I come in here. Because I don't want to forget what I'm trying to talk about. We talked about healthcare costs. You know what the average deductible is today? Anybody? Ballpark idea. $5,000. Yeah. It's $5,700 nationwide. But it's like 5,100 and something in Illinois. So you look at that. Do you remember when deductibles were 250? 500, we thought, oh man, that's going to kill me. Now it's 5,000. You work in a state that's so broke and bankrupt and upside down, do you think they're going to continue paying the low deductible? It's coming your way, guys. This is what's happening. They're going to shove it your way. I have several friends in the field that believe that we're on a path for $15,000 to $20,000 deductibles in the next decade. They don't want you going to your eye doctor. They don't want you going to your dentist or your MD for a quick checkup. They want you going when things are broken, catastrophic. Go in there when you have a heart attack. Then who cares about 20 grand? It's a $250,000 bill. 20, yeah. So what do you do? Then you think back, what did your grandparents do? Because they didn't have health insurance as we know it today before World War II. So what did they do? How'd they all get by? Everyone died when they were 30? Think about it. Think about your grandma, your grandpa. How many of them died when they were 30? How'd you get here? They didn't. You'd have things occasionally, but not everybody. So it's a little bit of a misnomer. And there's a reason grandma knew all the home remedies and passed it down, right? Because they couldn't afford to go to a doctor, or there wasn't one available to them. So they had to take care of themselves. That's what I do. I teach you guys how to take care of yourself. I try to re-educate you in things that people used to do that worked. And if you have a catastrophe, okay, I get it. There's a hospital down the street. Let them deal with it. But they want to go to this model. And it's a scary thing. Do you guys know the drug industry, when they modernized the FDA, they did it back in 96, and then we went back in front of it during the Bush administration. That administration, and whether you like it or not, it's irrelevant, it wouldn't have mattered who was in office. That administration signed over their rights for Medicare to negotiate drug prices, ever. They're not allowed to. They have to pay whatever the drug company wants. They are not allowed to negotiate. So you just took the largest population that you have, who would have the single largest buying power to negotiate a price down, and said, you can't. We're just going to pay. And so they set aside $500 million a year for it. And every year it's tapped through. That's just your Medicare. Do you see a problem? So now we look at this and we say, all right, what the heck does this have to do with blood sugar? Right? Sitting around, blah, 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 blah. So we start thinking about blood sugar. And we start thinking about what it does. And why we have it. And what's it do? What's the purpose of glucose? Does anyone know? Glucose is blood sugar for our purposes. Okay, that's what it is. So you start thinking about this a little bit. And you think glucose. Okay, it's fuel. It's energy. For what? That's the key. What is it fuel for? Your brain. Big fuel for your brain. Ironically, so is cholesterol. It's a big fuel for your brain. So when we're taking stuff to lower it all the time, we're taking meds and this and that, oh, get it down, get it down, get it down. Is it any surprise you see dementia increase with it? You're shutting the brain off. You're saying, hey, you don't need the gas to run. Now, glucose isn't everyday fuel for your brain. It's the holy crap fuel for your brain. It's, there's a bear, run. So you tap into the nitrous and you take off. You try and get away. You don't have an endless supply of it. Then you've got this hormone that the body uses. The hormone is called cortisol. And cortisol's job is to say, bear, run. I'm going to take all that sugar and pump it to the brain so he can find a way to run. And I'm going to throw a little bit at the eyes so it can find a way to get away from the bear. I use this one a lot because it makes sense to me. Has anyone ever been in an auto accident before? Or a car that's spinning on the ice? Doesn't everything look like it's going like this? Really slow, right? But it's not. You're going 60 miles an hour like this, but it looks like it's crawling around you. Because your brain said, bear, step on the gas, get the fuel up here. So anytime you're stressed, the body starts pumping that sugar into the blood up to the brain. But there's a problem with that. If you leave it in the blood too long, now all of a sudden another hormone you have kicks in and says, wait a minute, we're going to be diabetic. I got to drag this down. And so here comes insulin to the rescue. Now, insulin and cortisol are like two little brothers. Cortisol is the bigger, tougher, meaner one. So in the scheme of the fight, eventually he wins. And so all of a sudden you become insulin resistant or insulin sensitive. And that's where we're at today. This is diabetes. So we look at diabetes and we think, all right, there's different kinds, right? There's gestational, there's type 1, type 2. It used to be juvenile and adult onset, right? But those are the big three that you see. Gestational, less than 1% of all diabetics. Type 1s, you're born with it somehow, or you had a virus that damaged the tissue that produces insulin. Less than 5% of all diabetics. That means roughly 95% of your diabetics are type 2. Now, why is that important? Because type 2 is acquired diabetes. We weren't born with it. We didn't have some genetic flaw. We didn't anything like that. We did it to ourselves by accident. And so we say, gosh, we ate our way into that? Holy crap. But if we ate our way into it, why couldn't we turn around and eat our way back out? And we can. And that's the really cool part about it. You can turn it around. I haven't seen a diabetic in my practice probably in almost 2 decades that if they do what I ask, they can't flip their blood sugar around and get normal. That's not too bad. That's medication-free. Drug-free, because we know that's a plethora of God knows what going on there. You can reverse these things. So we go through this thing, and we think, okay, so insulin then, he stores fat. I forgot to tell you that, didn't I? Insulin, when he's packing that sugar and he's saying, get out of the blood so we're not diabetic, decides to stick it somewhere. Where can I put it? Oh, there's a fat cell. Ram it in there. Stick it in there. The fat cell goes... And later on, so do we. And we get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. Fat cells a lot like a storage unit, right? We've all had one at one time or another. This pop the door open, throw your boat in there, pull it down. Throw your old chair in there, pull it down. But they fill up, right? Fat cells don't. You pop it up, you roll the car in, close the door. 2 seconds later, you pop it up, there's no car. It's tucked off in the corner somewhere. The room got bigger. Cool. Fill it full of more stuff. And we... Whoosh. Sound effects are free. I'm kidding. So, does this make sense, right, how this happens? So this is what's going on inside you. And the body says, okay, I got this one hormone telling everybody to get off the boat. I got this other hormone saying, no, get back on. We're sinking. Go, go, go. Nope, get off, get on. Get off, get on. Get on. And your brain's going, Jesus, quit. Stop. Find the stress. Get rid of it so I can get off this merry-go-round. That's how this whole thing works. Does anyone know what an A1C test is?
Yeah.
All right. Gold standard for diabetes. It's a great test. I love the A1C. Because the A1C, and I'm visual. You don't mind if I draw, do you? A1C is like a secret. Okay, you know what a blood cell, right? A blood cell is a lot like a secret. And you remember the secrets that are a little more narrow in the middle? The old cough drop down? I don't even make it anymore.
They're delicious.
There you go. They're delicious. When I was a kid, I thought, man, these aren't the Ludens and those. Mom, can you give me the lemon-flavored Luden? Man, it's better than you. So the secret-looking, it's a blood cell, right? It's a red blood cell. And what happens is it's glycosylated hemoglobin. Well, that sounds fancy, right? Sugar stuck to blood. It's what it is. Your sugar that you don't digest... Start sticking to these blood cells and hanging on like tails. And now all of a sudden this thing starts getting bigger. Well, if your capillary that your arteries go into, say, man, we can let a blood cell slide right on through there. But we can't let that monster. He can't fit. So we got to leave him in the blood. Too big. Can't get out of the plumbing. Leave him in there. That's what they're measuring when they do an A1C. How many of these guys are still floating around inside there? Blood lives 120 days, roughly. That's how long its lifespan is. That's why they can do an A1C on you, and when they check it, oh man, you know, you're 6.9, which would be diabetic, right? Borderline, if not. You're 6.9. They're measuring 3 months ago. They're not measuring what you were that day. They're measuring what you did 3 months earlier. So when you do weight loss programs and all this stuff, and they say, oh, it didn't work, look, your A1C's still high. Did you wait till 3 months after I lost the weight? Or did you do it the day I finished? You need 6 months for it to show on an A1C. Not 30 days, not 90 days. You need 6 months. Then it'll show. So you look at this and you think, well, if these guys are sticking around inside there, and they're huge, right? They're massive. What happens when they come to the small plumbing? They stick together, and they clump, and they back up. It's like a traffic jam. My wife, I took her to Chicago recently to see a band. You guys ever hear of U2?
No.
If you don't, get out. I'm Irish. That's how it works. Okay, Prime Minister of Ireland was there. Come on. So U2 was doing a tour, and I'm a big one. So we went and saw them. But man, it was a cattle call getting out of there. We leave Soldier Field, and they run you out in front of that little, is the Field Museum, whatever that little museum is right there. They run you in front of that, but there's fences and police, and they herd you. And you're 200 deep going down to 4. And you are like, this feels really creepy bad. As you're walking along for a mile like this, and you feel like you're in the Second World War, going to a place that you don't want to go. It's like, this is not good. So as we're going through this, it's a very creepy feeling. That's what's happening here. The blood gets in there and it's pumping through the arteries and the veins, and all of a sudden it gets to the little ones and it says, yeah, I can't do this. But everybody behind you is already pushing. And so into the plumbing they go. And let's think, where do the arteries get small at? How about our toes and fingers? They get real little down there, don't they? You don't need great big huge ones here. So what that would mean then, if they get blocked up and you're going to cut off oxygen to the area, the tissue's going to change and it's going to probably necrose. The next thing you know, you're probably going to have to lose it. You understand why diabetics lose toes? You understand why they lose fingers? It's blood sugar problems. You know they also lose their eyesight? They go blind. Because how big do you think those arteries are in the eyes? Anyone ever have one break when your eyes all red for a while? Okay. Imagine the plumbing getting all clogged up in there, jammed up in there. Now you can't see. So aside from losing your fingers and toes, which apparently is not a big deal to most people, you're going to go blind. That's a big deal. How many of you like seeing? I mean, this is outstanding. You seeing it? Right? You don't want to have this visual guilt. There it is, right? Think about it. Think of all the cool things you've ever seen in your life. Don't you want to continue to try to see stuff? Maybe we don't always have that opportunity. Who would have ever thought that blood sugar could affect that? And you don't have to be diabetic to have this happen. You just have to have these guys forming. And it can happen. So then you start thinking, okay, what's the other problem? There's one more that has really small, no, I'm sorry guys, really small blood vessels, reproductive organs. Okay? They shut down. They don't work anymore. There's a reason they sell Viagra like candy. Right? It's all based on this. Now, if you guys, do you guys listen to the radio show, anybody? Okay? I do a radio show every Saturday morning. Have for 18 years. Yeah, I was talking this weekend, sex after 50. Outstanding. Right? If you have sex after 50, you live longer and you remember better. It fights dementia. Why? Hormones, it's endorphins. Oh, and it increases blood flow and pressure, doesn't it? Who'd have thought? So all of you tonight, I'm saying. I'm saying. Better get frisky.
You're over 50.
Oh. So diabetes. You're like, game on. Here we go.
Biggest point I think.
So we look at diabetes now, right? We're thinking about this and we think, okay, so what does it do to all these chronic illnesses, right? See, one of the problems we have with our medical model today, and I'm not anti-medicine by any means at all. I'm not anti-medicine. I had this talk with a young lady the other day. Okay? Medicine does some really wonderful things. They've saved millions of lives with inventions and cures and cares and all these things, right? They've done a lot of cool stuff. But they've also done a lot of really, really, really not cool stuff. And some really bad things. And their model is very, the term is mechanistic. Right? You're a machine. They pop the hood, replace a water pump, and move on. That's how they see us. And the problem with that model is that it was really, really good when we died of typhoid and cholera. And we died of injuries in a mine when I'm 9 years old. And you see the canary go boom. And the little kid goes, and everyone else runs. You learn, oops, gas. But now, today, we're not dying of those things. We learned, clean our water supply. That was the idea. Wash the water. There's a reason the old cultures drank whiskey.
water wasn't safe. Nobody wanted to take a chance on it. Right? Look at Montezuma's Revenge when you go to Mexico. Right? Dysentery's not a good day. I'll take the whiskey. The Irish had it right once again. Just saying. Okay? So we look at this and we think to ourselves, all right, so that model was set up to deal with trauma and catastrophe and infections. And it's good at that. But we die from one of the top killers. What's the top one we mentioned before? Heart disease, number one. Who's two?
Cancer.
Cancer's two. Who'd be three then? There's a little battle there between three and four a little bit. So cancer, stroke tends to roll in there at three. Four, five, bounce back and forth the last couple years. It was diabetes. Alzheimer's has leaped it a couple times in the last few years. And you think, now wait a minute, diabetes is in rampant proportion. How did Alzheimer's come out of nowhere and jump it? Because Alzheimer's, as we're learning now, the nickname for it is type 3 diabetes. It's tied to your blood sugar. So I'm going to forget who I am. I'm probably going to have a stroke, a heart attack, or cancer. And if I'm lucky enough, I'll forget it because I've got the diabetes that's feeding the whole bear. And when you have diabetes, your odds of developing a stroke, a heart attack, cancer, or Alzheimer's is about 300% higher than the rest of the population. Anybody want some? Hell no. Not even no, hell no. You don't want this. You don't want to go down that road. So what if you don't have to? See, that's the question. What if you don't have to go down that road? What if you could predict where it's going? What if you knew where it's going? What if you could watch somebody every single day and know where it's going? Would it be worth trying to avoid? The silence means no, and that's job security for me, but it's not good for you guys. Okay? When you go to a grocery store, all you have to do is watch people put their cart on there. Just watch them unpack. And you can predict which one's going to be diabetic. You just watch it, and you'll know immediately. You're looking really for two things. You're looking for any kind of cola. Doesn't matter what. And you're looking for something that's going to have high fructose corn syrup in it and grains. Those are your diabetes formers. Those are your blood sugar challenges. There's other things, but those are the big two. Those are the two that are really going to get you. So you start watching this thing roll across the conveyor belt and you see the Coke go on by. You watch the Pepsi go on by. You watch the Mountain Dew and the 800 grams of sugar or whatever's in that thing. Then you watch the white bread and the donuts and the pie. Don't forget the candy bar. You're going to throw that in there, right? So we start going there, but the good news is you bought the Crystal Light. Right? That's the theory, at least. But it doesn't work. Because what we've learned now is the fake sweeteners, the artificial sweeteners, which are 300 to 500 times sweeter than table sugar. All right? They crush your blood sugar and your weight. And so as your weight starts to climb, what happens to your sugar? Because weight is a stress. And we know stress is a bear. And we run from bears. So when the weight goes up, bang, there it is. We get scared, bang, there it is. We get behind on our bills, there's a bear. Anybody in here ever have any of those?
No. Every day.
Right? Welcome to the world, right? It's stress. So we know stress then becomes the cause of all disease. And you use that little hormone, that little insulin guy, to try to bail water in a boat that's sinking. But insulin's not very big. So I gave you a teaspoon, and I said, get at it. And you're bailing as fast as you can. You need a pump. Not this. You can't get enough water out. And so the boat starts to boom. And every time it sinks a little deeper into the water, it gives you another symptom, another problem, another thing showing up. And the scary part is that from a medical standpoint, where their model is used to acute care trauma and things breaking, you haven't broken yet. So the body's giving you all these symptoms, but nothing's broken. So your doctor's like, well, Mrs. Smith, you're pre-this, you're pre-that. It's like being almost pregnant. Really? How are you pre-anything? Everyone's pre-something. The second you're born, you're pre-diabetic. You're pre-pregnant. All right? I mean, you're pre-constipated. Sure. It'll happen at some point. No, well, look, they were right. Like a fortune teller. They were right. They told me I was pre-constipated. Now I am 50 years later. Does it make sense? It's not hard to predict things when you know the outcome, you know where it's going to go eventually, as long as you don't intervene. But what if you can intervene? What's the cause of all disease? That's close. We'll go stress first. Stress is the cause of all disease and the marker that doesn't work. So we'll move on. If I could draw a bear right now, you'd know it'd be up there. All right. Stress is the cause of all disease. The guy that said it was up for a Nobel Prize for medicine for saying, and he was an endocrinologist, I don't have a Nobel Prize. So I have to assume he wasn't a complete idiot. All right? I wouldn't mind the Nobel Prize if anyone ever gets one and wants to share it. So I look at this and I think, okay, you got an endocrinologist. And endocrinology studies hormones, hypothalamus, pituitary, thyroid, adrenals, and how they function in the body. And hormones are used for dealing with
stress.
There it is. And so I tease. I always say, man, men are the cause of all stress. This is what gets you in trouble. It's their fault. You can blame them. It's okay, I do. And I use a little triangle and I say, all right, what does that mean? Your body has three sides, three triangles, three pieces that hold it together as one unit. One of those pieces is your mechanical side, right? It's your bones and your muscles and all the good things you got. But stuff goes wrong with them. Anybody in here not have something that currently feels stiff, sore, or hurts? No. Right? I mean... Who doesn't? I pop and I'm like, click, click. I'm like, hey, that wasn't so good. Right? We all do. So guess what? You all have some of this currently. But the good news is, the thing you're living in right now, it's like, yeah, I'll figure it out. I'll adapt. Then we have the E. That's our emotional side, right? Anybody in here think they don't have emotional stress? If you're sitting in here, you have emotional stress. I'm not that entertaining. Right? That's how this works. You're like, I gotta go see him. So you know there's something going on over here. And then the last one is what? It's our nutritional side. Things we eat, things we drink, air we breathe. It's the chemicals in our life. Now, I use this a lot because I think it makes sense to people. Right? What can you control the easiest? What's the that's it. You control the nutrition side. You ever try to not have your neck hurt when you roll out of bed in the morning? Good luck. Tell, I ain't not going to hurt today. I'm just going to get up. Maybe. But odds are really good. It's going to do what it wants. And you don't have a say. Went to bed. Oh, I slept great. You get up. Your foot hits the floor. You're like, what's going on? You roll out of the car and something hurts for no reason. Welcome to this world. Go over here. Get that bill in the mail you didn't expect. Get that call. I had some guy blow up my phone. I told you this the other day. I had a guy blow up my phone yesterday. It was yesterday. I bet I had 25 phone calls from this guy. What is he from? Fort Myers, Florida, or Orlando? Or Fort Lauderdale? Fort Lauderdale, Florida. Over and over. I'm not answering. I'm like, I don't know who's from Fort Lauderdale. Let that thing ring. Didn't leave a message. But over and over and over. And finally he left a message. He says, hey man, I can't stay in that hotel. Blah, 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 blah. You guys double billed me. I'm not coming in. You charge me online. I'm like, so I thought, I'll text him. Hey, buddy, I'm not a hotel. Sure you are. Here's your number. And he sends me a picture of the website and their number. And he transposed two of them. I'm like, no, no. That one right there. That's wrong. That's the hotel. Call it. Sorry, oh my God. That's emotional stress. He was flipping out because he got double charged. When I was a kid, we were poor. We didn't have a lot, right? And so my mom, and maybe some of you are in the same boat. You go to a grocery store, right? And you got five kids and a mom dragging you all around a cart in the store, right? And you get there and you can't touch anything. God help you touch something. And they put all of that right there at the end. And you're like, come on. No, 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 no. You get all done and she walks to the end and starts going through the cart. Thing by thing on that receipt. And I mean, if there is two pennies that are off,
we're standing in line for the next half an hour to get our 2 cents back. I mean, that's just how it was, right? That's my mom. That was stressful to her. She wanted her 2 cents. All right, but you spend a half an hour to get 2 pennies. I can find it in the driveway. Nope. That's what we're going to do. So then we go to this guy, the nutrition side. What's that all about? It's what we eat. It's what we drink. It's what we breathe. All right, we can't control what we breathe that well. That's kind of hard, right? There's all kinds of stuff going on out there. But what about what we eat or what we drink? Those are pretty good, right? So in my practice, I use these as a foundation. I say, all right, if I'm going to put up a fight, I'm going to start there. That's the piece I can control of this thing. I know this causes all disease. I know he got a Nobel Prize for it. And I think to myself, well, if that's the case, then I can actually help sick people get well. I just have to know how. Then I got to know where to start. And I have to have you help me. Because literally all I can do is put you in front of that trough of water and decide you're thirsty. You can stand there all day. Good news is I'm Irish and we're used to hardship and struggle, so I'll wait. I can wait and wait and wait and wait. Eventually you guys put. When I get you there, all of a sudden your life starts to change. You start seeing things turn around. And the cool part is you come in and go, Doc, you know I'm diabetic and I got all these things going on. You know what? I got this horrible hip pain. Cool. I'm going to work you this way. That's where we're going. Or no, hey, I'm bipolar and schizophrenic. I'm okay with that. We're going this way, though. Okay, we're going to go there. But the good news is when I get it balanced, when I get enough of both of these sides, whatever way we go, balance, then I turn the corner and I work the other side. You have to. You've got to balance the body. Because if you don't control blood sugar, you have no chance of fixing someone. None. You can Band-Aid till the cows come home, and that's all great and dandy, but it doesn't ever fix anything. Remember the cancer, the stroke, the heart attack, and the Alzheimer's we talked about? Remember the $400,000 you're all going to spend? How many of those $400,000 cures any of those things? If any, it would be cancer, right? And that's only because they can cut it out, burn it out, or poison it. Aside from that, you ever see anyone go through cancer therapy? Chemotherapy, radiation, all the neuropathies and the crap that comes for years afterwards.
If right? They survive.
If they survive. Now, if they survive, that's awesome. They got a piece of their life and hopefully they can find a new way. But a lot of them don't make it. A lot don't make it. And I've seen enough of it in my lifetime that I don't want to wait until the body breaks and get something like that before I intervene. What if it's predictable? What if you can see it coming? Well, Sean, you already said we could always do is watch people go down the grocery line and put their crap on a container and watch it go by. We already know who's going to get the problems. And Penn State and Harvard have done some phenomenal research projects on this. Do you know that cancer, stroke, heart attack, diabetes, 80% preventable? Good enough. I'll take the 20% chance that nature screwed me. I'm okay with that. But man, 8 out of 10 is pretty good odds if I can step up and do something about it. 8 out of 10, you can avoid it all. You never have to watch somebody get put on a morphine drip trying to stay alive, trying to stop the pain, watching them die. It sucks. I've done it a lot. It's not fun. It's hard. And then it's their family of and how they now have to cope with it. Guys, this is about taking your life back. I'm going to try to show you a blueprint for how to do that. And if you can follow the blueprint, and you're willing to step up a little bit, you'll see things change. Blood sugar. It swings up and down, up and down. We're familiar with it. Highs and lows. How do you know if yours is in trouble? I got to give you stuff, right? You're here. You got to have little tricks, little tidbits. Things you can go home and, oh man, I'm in trouble. Here's an easy one. We want it to do that. That's kind of the rule. Down the middle. Don't let it get going too much, because once it starts hopping, it's like power lines in a storm. The wind starts hitting them, they're going to dance. When they dance, they tend to break. No more power. Things go out, meat goes bad, my mom's going to wash it in the basement, paddle around in the deep water. I'll tell you that story in a little while. Normal blood sugar, 120. That's the high.
low 60. Right? Makes sense? That's what it is. That's the range. And medically, our tests say, you're in there, you're doing good. But reality says, no. We're all unique. We're all individuals. None of us are the same. So we look at that and we think to ourselves, well, what does that mean? That means I can take any young lady in this room and say, your sugar's going to move 20 points up or down because you're unique. And maybe I'm in here and it's like, you're only going to move 10. And this all came out of UCLA in their research study years ago. It's very interesting stuff. And they found that everybody has their own little finite movement of their blood sugar that their body likes. You may be 30 points, you may be 10, you may be 6, you may be 15. Everybody's different. We're not all average. Let's do that real quick. Who in here is average? Who here is you're just average? Well, what's wrong with you? I mean, aren't we average? Isn't that how we treat everybody? We use the same blood pressure meds, the same diabetic drugs, the same heart meds, the same Alzheimer's drugs, same diet for everybody. We're all average, aren't we? Well, why don't all of you agree with me? It's a problem. We're not average. It's nice to think that we are, but we're not all a Toyota out in the front yard where you're popping the hood and everything looks the same. We're unique. We're different. We can look at the bodies that, they're similar, but they're different. And so what this study found was that if you woke up in the morning and your blood sugar, say, 70, you eat lunch or something of that nature and it runs to 95, you are well within normal limits. You didn't exceed anything medically. But in their study, they noticed, wait a minute, people have problems when they go beyond their threshold. So if you go up too fast, 20 is her rule, she went 25, the body will exhibit what they call hypoglycemic reactions, which are characterized by anxiety-type effects. Moody, irritable, fidgety, can't hold still. Anyone ever see these little spinning fidgets? How many million of those do you think they've sold? Who are they selling them to?
You.
Me, absolutely. Right here. Anxiety-type people, high-energy people, people that fidget all the time. Blood sugar swings. You think about that. Moody, irritable, fidgety. Anybody in here ever get moody? Right?
No.
It doesn't have to be every day, all day. It just has to hit you once. Literally, your day's going pretty good, and all of a sudden, you're just mad as hell. You're like, what happened? How did it happen? Half an hour later, it goes, whoop. And you're like, I don't know what's going on. I don't know who that person was. They came out of nowhere. You know, you're thinking, holy cow. That's all it is. It's just a blood sugar swing. And then it has to come back down. So when it goes whoosh, it's got to come back down. What if it goes down faster than your threshold can handle? It goes the other way. So on its way back down, now all of a sudden, you go to a hypoglycemic reaction, which is characterized by depression. Or depressive-like symptoms. What would those be? Fatigue, forgetfulness, insomnia, exhaustion. Anybody in here ever tired? Anybody in here not sleep well? Anybody in here have a hard time remembering where they put their keys when they're holding them? I've been there, believe me, I know. I'm thinking, really? I've looked around my house for half an hour with my cell phone and it's in my shirt pocket. And I'm flipping out. I'm telling my wife, it's not just, it's everybody. We all do this, right? The key is you got to get it under control. And so there's a test that I use in practice. I do it during my weight loss program. When people lose the weight at the end, I use something called functional neurology that a mentor of mine, Viktor Frankl, taught me. It's how to reset this ripple. And it came out of UCLA Medical School in the late 1950s. And what bothers me is that, well, we've known about this since the 50s. What the hell are we doing? Why aren't we helping people then? If we've known about this for 60 years, why aren't we helping people? It concerns me a little bit. And I think, gosh, there's people out there that are moody and cranky and irritable and fidgety and sad and depressed and lethargic and fatigued. And forgetful. Did I mention forgetful? Forgetful, right? dementia, Alzheimer's. Where do you think it fits in here? This is blood sugar. Now the entire thing is controlled by your adrenal gland. And the adrenal gland has a little special health hormone that he likes to use called cortisol. We talked about him earlier, right? So he produces the cortisol for you. And the cortisol is what gets this thing hopping real good. And then insulin's gonna kick in on the other end and say, can't leave you here. Gotta take you out of the blood. You're gonna make you diabetic. Where can I put you? Oh, that garage. Shove it in. And we go, and get bigger, and bigger, and bigger, and bigger. Now, it would be conspiracy theory of me to think that the food industry might have some idea of how to get you addicted to things. They might understand that we really like salt, we really like sugar, and we really like fat. And we mix those three together, it is catnip for human beings. We are like, woo, this is outstanding. Sit down in a bowl of M&Ms. Grab a bag of chips. See what you can do to them. Get a little moody while you're doing it. Man, comfort food. Woo, here it comes. That's what we do, right? And the problem with that is that if that stuff's going on and it's spiking this stuff, then it makes me eat more. I eat more, I store more. I store more, I get bigger just like I store more. And all of a sudden, here I am. I'm on this merry-go-round. I can't get off. Because there's an industry, theoretically, that might know that I have a weakness. Now, of course, that's theory. It'd be foolish for us to think that any industry would ever try to market their product better. Right? Or figure out genetically how to do things to us. Surely not. Unless we smoke, of course, right? Because the tobacco industry, we know, for sure, fooled us. We know they did. Hell, they had doctors in front of you telling you how good it was in the 50s. Smoke cools are great for you. It's the brand I choose, minus my lung cancer. Does that make sense? Then you start thinking, well, doesn't RGL Reynolds own Kraft Foods? They do. And so you start thinking to yourself, so wait a minute, Kraft and Nabisco are tied, and RGL Reynolds, who did the tobacco thing, they studied human beings enough to know that we're addicted to nicotine, we're addicted to this and that. And man, if they understood salt, sugar, and fat, you think they might try to make things go that way? Theoretically, right? I could be full of shit, right? It could happen. Okay? But you look at this one, you think, well, if that's the case, if that were really truly what's happening, then food would have to change. We have to look at things and think, well, 1970 is a great year. A lot of crap happened in the 70s. So we look at the 1970s, early 1970s, and the average bite of food before you felt it was safe to chew and swallow, and this is documented in New England Journal of Medicine, you can look it all up, okay, 23 times before you felt like you could swallow it safely. Anyone know what the average is today?
Three.
Wow.
Three. For your diet, it is three.
Wow.
So you think, what did they do to that food to make it break down, dissolve faster, so I feel like I'm not going to choke when I swallow it? What did they do? They figured out salt, fat, and sugar, catnip, all I got to do is make it dissolve faster so they'll eat more. And when they eat more, what happens? Here it goes. They get moody, they get cranky, they get tired, fatigued, pissed off, and depressed. They can't reproduce because it all affects reproduction. We already talked about that. So you get a whole lot of infertile females, a lot of guys that are pissed off, and no one wants to have sex anymore because it hurts, or something's wrong, or it doesn't work, but there's Viagra. And you look at this and you start thinking to yourself, wow, then we'd have all kinds of infertility issues going on in our country. Anyone ever know anybody that has that? It's all based on blood sugar. If you can control the swings, you can control everything I've been talking about. It's all you have to do. Now let's throw one more thing in there. 1970s. High fructose corn syrup. We talked about that, right? Remember Coke and the grains and all that stuff I mentioned? High fructose corn syrup came into our diet in the 1970s. It's a cheap alternative to sugar. All right. Now, if I'm not completely nuts again, all we have to do is look it up, right? Go on CDC's website. Start looking up diabetes. How much diabetes was there prior to 1970? 1980, we had 5.6 million. 2010, we had 20.9 million. So I think, all right, we introduced this into our food chain early 1970s, 73, 74, 5, 6, 7, 8 years of doing it, we get about 5 million diabetics. 30 years of doing it, we get 5 times that many. See a problem? They're predicting by 2050, half the population will be diabetic. Guys, it's this. I'm trying to show you a blueprint. I'm trying to show you a way out. How do you know if you're in trouble? Look at things. Do I get tired? Do I get anxious? Do I get moody? Do I get cranky? You're in trouble. The most obvious physical tell, watch anybody stand up. Anyone, watch them walk. And if you see a shoulder doing this, and there's not an injury, there's a blood sugar problem. 100% guaranteed. All you do is watch them. Watch them walk. You can tell. The body has ways of showing you what's going on. It's not going to tell me it's 300. It'll just say, hey, something's wrong. So where's my volunteer? Gotta have someone, right? No guts, no glory. I can already see it on you.
I'm gonna take this guy right here.
I can see it.
Yeah, yeah, her. Right here.
Might have some fun with this, right?
Okay.
Okay. Turn, cup and wait. This way doing practice. Cup and wait. That's a problem. There you go. Come on back.
Now. She's walking to
her. Got that. She's got the whole princess walk. Girl, you're rocking it. Turn for me. Did you ever injure your right shoulder severely? If you're umming, you can't remember.
Yeah,
so that
remember.
Means no. So just stand there and face
she
everybody and smile.
Okay?
What do you see?
I see everybody.
I'm on the same bones. What do you all see?
One tire.
Absolutely. If we turn it around, it gets even better. Here we go. I gotta duck out of your way. Bottom of the scapula. Bottom of the scapula. What do you see?
Left side.
So if I had a question for her, and I'd say, man, do you have shoulder problems, mid-back pain, neck issues? Why? Because these muscles go, and they're pulling like this. Now you have physical things that are going to show up because of this. It's not rocket science. It's just straight anatomy. It's straight anatomy and physiology. Right?
Oh, run.
You're right. It is. It's
a bear.
Right? It's the bear. She's got something in her life that body is saying, man, I got to pump sugar into the blood so I can deal with it. All right, you got to find it. Because if you don't find it, what is coming? You're not going to be able to sleep well. You're going to get anxious, moody, and cranky, which we may already be there. All right, we're going to get forgetful. That might be good because you won't remember you're moody and cranky. So that's good, right? And then we're going to crave like mad. And when we crave, we're going to overeat. We overeat. What's it going to do to the digestive system when you overfill it? You're going to stretch it. When you stretch it, what's going to happen? Anyone hear reflux heartburn? Gastritis? Anyone have that?
I have all of them.
It's called, once again, job security. I'm here all week and catch another show at 7. Okay? So, you get this? You see the pattern? It's predictable. That's what this doctor was trying to say. He was an ER doctor before he became an endocrinologist. That's what he was doing. He was doing his residency. And he was trying to tell you, it is predictable. You can see the writing on the wall. The problem is, the people that are after you and trying to get your pennies are a little more clever than we are individually. It's hard to outthink 50 people. It's just tough. And when those 50 people have unlimited resources and unlimited income, and they learn your habits and your patterns. Kind of like, anyone have a cell phone in here? Who gets crap on their emails now that's advertisements? Because your phone is learning your patterns. You don't think someone else tried it first? They have. And they know you guys. And they know what you're all about. And they know what's going on. Do you know how many people take heartburn medication in this country? Adults? Almost 60% are guaranteed to take some type of heartburn med in a 12-month period. 60% of your population has digestive problems? Heartburn, gastritis, constipation, diarrhea, bloating, distension, gas. Anybody? Sign up, okay? This is what I do. Sign up, all right? So you look at that. You know how many babies they give heartburn medication to now? Almost 40%. What in the hell is that about? Babies spit up. They have forever. A colicky baby's just poor digestion. FYI, if you want to fix it, it's a super easy thing to do. Okay? But aside from that, they don't need Prilosec and Nexium and Zantac and Axid and all this crap. They're babies. So you look at these things, you think, gosh, if this is the direction we're going, and we're now putting crap in to shut off digestion, and that's what those drugs do, right? They shut it off. You get rid of stomach acid. What do we need stomach acid for, right? We digest them. It turns digestion on. Shut it off. Well, then how do you absorb your minerals? If you can't absorb your minerals, what happens to your bones? You start borrowing the minerals from the bones. And you start thinking of things like osteoporosis, right? Fractures and compression fractures. And now all of a sudden you're getting injections of Fosamax and Boniva. What else I got in here that's exciting? I'm down the home stretch. You're getting ready to leave on me. I feel it. I'm sensing it.
So does that make—
how's that? I can predict. It's going out the door. Look at that. Ta-da. Yes, go ahead.
You were saying that it pulls from your bones. Your teeth too,
yeah,
then?
Yeah, it's just bones, right? How many women have been pregnant here? How many women noticed their teeth change when they were pregnant? Right? You notice that something's just not right. Your hair, your nails, your skin. Baby's like, give it all here. If I don't have it to your diet, I'm going to take it from you. You're a big piggy bank for me. And it just keeps pulling. So yeah, absolutely. It'll pull from your hair, your teeth, your nail. Pull anywhere it can.
For
right?
The rest of your life.
Absolutely. It does. But the good news is you can reverse that. That's a bear. He's a little one. And he's going to get bigger. As he grows, his problems will too. So you have to deal with that later on. But ideally, it's a bear, right? So this morning I was on Fox's Good Day Marketplace. I join them every couple times a week on Fox. And we were talking about coconut oil. Anyone see it?
Man, you guys don't watch TV. I'm a rock star. I'm all like...
All right. So you can go on Facebook and watch it again later, but it was a good section. It was on coconut oil. And the American Heart Association came out this week and said, no more. Coconut oil is not good for you. Stay away from the saturated fats. They have no benefit whatsoever because it raises your LDL. Your bad cholesterol, right? So let's look at this. Bad cholesterol. And they didn't like me on the show this morning because they had these kind of pre-planned questions for me to kind of go through with them and this and that. I said, it's all bullshit. It's a bunch of crap. Well, the American Heart Association says they're wrong. Send them my way. I'll tell them. You're wrong.
Well, it's old thinking.
Well, and that's it. It's archaic thinking, and it's really stupid. Because when they go through this, you think, okay, LDL, bad cholesterol. All right, well, what does cholesterol do in the body? What does it do? Remember I said it's a fuel for the brain? Uh-huh. And we use it to make all of our reproductive hormones, all of them. So it's a fuel for the brain, and it's a building block for your hormones so you can reproduce. It's also a key component to your cell wall for the cell to stay healthy. It's like bricks and mortar to repair things that have been damaged by storms and earthquakes and stuff like that. So we really use it a lot. Now, which one do we use? Do we use the HDL, the VLDL, the triglyceride portion, or the LDL? The LDL is what the body has to survive on. Without it, we die. Everybody dies without it. So you think, wait a minute, we're taking a med to not have LDL. We're trying to lower, lower, lower. And coconut oil is what they were talking about. Well, it raises LDL. That's horrible, right? It's terrible. Oh, my God, we can't have that up there. But then we go back and think saturated fats. What are saturated fats? Those are fats that are solid roughly at room temperature. Lard, butter, those are good solids, right? Coconut oil, solid room temperature. Now we're coming back to our blood sugar concept here, right? We're thinking, okay, so fat now is really important for the body. And if we can't get the fat for fuel, what do we eat? If you can't get fat for fuel, what are you going to eat? You got it. We're going after things that are sweet, quick, and easy. You can't burn the oak fire log. You're going to go buy newspaper. Throw it in there. That's easy to light. So we eat sugar. So when we can't use fat, we turn to sugar. And we turn to sugar, what happens? Boom. Off it goes. So we look at this thing. We start thinking saturated fat, animal fats. Oh, they're horrible for us. We're all going to die. But then I started thinking, well, let me just look up some stuff before I go on TV today and make sure I'm not an idiot.
I don't mind being dumb, but I don't mean anything. So I'm going through there and I'm looking and I'm thinking to myself, okay, what was the incidence of heart disease in, say, 1910? How many people in this country died of heart disease? It was so low they didn't count it. And a doctor by the name of White came back from Germany in around 1920, went to Harvard Medical School and said, oh my God, I've got this electrocardiogram, an EKG, this is awesome. And the doctors at the time said, don't waste your time with it. You won't see enough people in your career to use it. That's in 1920. Fast forward to 1970. How many people in this country have heart disease? It goes up. What did we change? We got away from animal fats and lard and all those things and said, hey, eat margarine. Here's Crisco. It's good for you. But it's not. So our consumption of vegetable oils in that last 80-year period has gone up 400%. Our consumption of the animal fats, the saturated fats, in that same 80 years has dropped 25% overall. What do you think heart disease has done? What's the number one killer in the country? All follows this. Guys, this is it. I'm trying to show you. It's very hard for me because I'm sitting in a room full of people where, does anyone here not feel good? Anybody? You feel like you did when you graduated high school. Put your hands up if you do. Okay? I got one that feels exactly like he did when he graduated high school. He's like, he can run, he can jump, he can go out, play basketball for 4 hours and still walk the next day. Okay? I'm good with him. How many people are in this room? Look around. We got one that feels that way. That means the rest of you don't feel good. You're okay with it? Is it okay? Is it okay to feel like crap? Is it okay to not have any energy? Is it okay to be tired? Is it okay for things to hurt? We just accept it? It's normal? It's not. That's the point I'm getting at. It's not normal. But I have to get you guys to see that, wait a minute, this isn't normal. I need to get the hell off this merry-go-round and get my life back. I'm going to use you in my back corner. Okay, Terry? Sure. She's a great storyteller. I love Cher. Right, it's a great story for me. She's doing weight loss. Okay, I'm not here to do this with you. I don't want to talk about weight loss. Okay, I want to talk about you getting your life back.
It's gotten a lot better. Let's put it like that.
Think about how you used to hurt. Knees, joints, pain. She's got a young granddaughter that she likes to run around with and do things with, and that was her motivating force for getting her life back. Right? Guys, pain sucks.
I'm tired of feeling the way I was feeling.
You know, you used to be super active. You golfed. You did all that stuff, right? Mm-hmm. How much of that did you do when you were feeling bad? Mm-hmm. So you gave up it, right? Hey, guys, what did you guys like to do when you were kids? Did you have anything you like to do?
Run,
play, swing, hopscotch, you know, you're doing this number, right? We all like to do that. Why don't you like to do it now? It's not, right? You're afraid. You're hurt. You're afraid. You're tired. You can't do it. You don't have the energy. You don't have the energy to play. You don't have the energy to be who you are. Remember Peter Pan? His marbles, right? How do you get back to Neverland? He had to remember what it was like to be a kid again. You guys have to go back. Right? You got to go back to being a kid. Yes, sir.
My granddaughter's got a birthday coming up. She'll be 7. She's having a skating party.
Nice. Nice. You absolutely should. Absolutely should. Hug that wall.
Yeah.
Hug the wall. Don't be shooting the duck. Okay? Hug that wall, girl.
I'll be okay if not rollerblades.
You know what? That's awesome, though. And you would have never even thought about that a year ago.
No. And I'm coming up to the point where it was last August that her and I went to the Muni, and I had a terrible experience out there because I couldn't walk down and walk back up and walk down and walk back up.
Yeah.
And this year it's going to be so much better.
Yeah. Yay. You're going to rock solid. It's super exciting. Super exciting. Guys, it's about that. It's about getting your life back. Okay? So we have to have a solution to our problem. How do you do it? What do you do? All right? Two options.